It's New York City. It's the 1920s. We've got jazz, we've got flappers, the foxtrot, universal suffrage, prohibition. I mean, it's the roaring fucking 20s. Everything's going on. And we remember this time today for its bottomless debauchery and exuberance, for carefree reverie and spending, and of course for that ultimate desire to cleanse the new century of outdated, boring Victorian morals. In the post-war euphoria, it wasn't just stocks and cocktails that were booming. Divorce, too, was growing at an alarming, unprecedented rate. And linked to all of this is, the women's new freedoms that they were not just enjoying, but also paradoxically suffering. Against this backdrop, Ursula Parrott publishes her first novel in 1929 called Ex-Wife. The book was an immediate, huge success, making her instantly famous, instantly rich, and of course a target for male envy and everything that comes with that. She and her reputation were eventually relegated to that obscure genre of pulpy women's romance. Ex-Wife is the story of women's struggles with adultery, with heartbreak, with independence, and all of this in the face of a budding feminism that's still not defined enough, that's still not mature enough to give women the necessary tools to navigate this new freedom and its consequences. It's raw, it's funny, it's heartfelt and flippant, it's melancholy and melodramatic, and it's the book that we're finally going to be reading here today on Litscapes. All right, everyone, welcome finally to Litscapes. I'm excited to be doing this at last. Gotta admit, I am a bit nervous. Right, this is our first episode slash pilot slash test. We'll see how it goes, but we're finally here, and it's an honor, it's a pleasure to be sharing this with all of you guys. So Litscapes, what is this? What are we doing? Why are we here, right? This podcast is an attempt to share with you guys just a little bit of my reading experience. The plan here is not for this to be a class, right? We just want to be sharing a book that we're reading throughout the month, right? The idea here is that we're going to be choosing a book every month, and we'll be reading throughout. We'll be commenting, we'll be sharing through different social media platforms. And at the end, we're going to be doing this podcast, this episode, at the end of each month, to read live with all of you. Not live. In real time, we'll be reading that last chapter and finish the book all together, right? See how we feel about it, see what it makes us think, see if it moves us. That's the idea here, right? To be finishing this book all together for the first time. So that's a little bit of where the podcast is about, where it's headed, why we're doing this, right? Something a little bit new, something fresh, right? It's not so much a review about a book, but a sharing of that experience, reading it, right? And as such, you guys will be able to follow us as well on Instagram, on TikTok. Please don't forget to follow us on those different channels. What I want is not just a bookstagram, because that's, you know, anyone's doing bookstagrams nowadays, right? And it's boring. It's a cliche. It's a fucking foregone conclusion, right? I don't want to be here showing off the books that I'm getting. I don't want to be here organizing my bookshelf by colors and arranging my books into different shapes. Whatever, boring, right? You guys can do that if you want at home. The idea of also the Instagram is to be sort of recording and sharing that reading experience, the reading journey of the books we're going to be reading together, right? So sharing thoughts, sharing feelings, sharing comments, sharing opinions, right? All of this I want to be the trajectory leading up to this moment where we're finally finishing the book. So that's the gist of how the show is going to go, all right? Be advised, there will be spoilers, naturally, right? So guys, if you haven't read up to this point, I suggest you stop now and, you know, read the book, catch up, up until the penultimate chapter, and come back, right? Because we're going to be pretty much discussing everything. Be advised. All right, so this is Litscapes. Finally, we got the show on the road, and let's get down then to business. The book we're going to be talking about today is rather obscure, but before we get to it, let me just share with you a little bit of my experience teaching literature at high school. The one book that I've never changed from, taken out of the syllabus from the many years I've been working doing this, is The Great Gatsby. You may have heard of it. There's actually a pretty good movie from about 10 years ago with Leonardo DiCaprio. But the book is just, it's one of my all-time favorites. And so I never take it out of the syllabus, right? It's always there. I'm always teaching it. I always enjoy it. It's a great book for different reasons. First of all, like I said, it's one of my favorites. There it is, right? I enjoy reading it every year, but more so I enjoy teaching it every year. And it tends to be also one of the favorites among the students. They like it. I mean, I'm glad they do, but they like it more than the other books I tend to select. The themes are, I think, contemporary, right? The whole, the American dream, the illusion, the disillusionment. The language is not also too complicated, right? It's a fairly simple, straightforward read that the students can appreciate, can enjoy, can understand, right? Especially being in English. So it's a book that works on multiple levels, right? But also I like it because it really captures the essence of that moment in history. The 1920s, New York, right? Everyone was going wild. Everyone was having a blast. Again, that's why it's the Roaring 20s. It's the Jazz Age. It's the Gilded Age. And so it captures that essence, right? It captures not just the high, the drunkenness, but it also captures the hangover, right? The rise and fall of the decade of Gatsby. And it's just a great fun read. I love it. And again, I like to think that my students in general love it as well, right? But it turns out that it's not the only book that really captures the 1920s. And it's not even the only great book. So it turns out that recently fortuitously, I discovered a book called Ex-Wife by Ursula Parrott. This is what I've been reading for the past month. This is what we're gonna be finishing today, right? Ex-Wife, Ursula Parrott. Published in 1929. Gatsby is from 1925, definitely contemporaries. Couple of wild people, these authors. In fact, there are rumors that Ursula Parrott had a little thing going with Fitzgerald at some point, right? Fitzgerald, I think Hemingway as well. So you can imagine what type of character we're talking about, right? Ursula Parrott. Wildly rich at the time, right? With this first novel she publishes, she makes a lot of money. Ultimately, I think she ends up being a millionaire, which back then meant, right, a lot of money. And just goes crazy with it, right? Ends up in Hollywood, rubbing elbows with celebrities, you know, loses all her money, her fortune eventually in shopping, right? She was fashion obsessed. Parties, drinking, alcohol for her was just like Fitzgerald, ultimately a problem. Ends up bankrupt. At one point ends up homeless, sleeping in subways, and dies young at like 58, I think, kind of forgotten in a charity ward of a cancer hospital. So a bit tragic, right? But she published a lot. I think it's around 20 novels, a bunch of short stories, screenplays. In fact, this first novel, Ex-Wife, was actually turned into a film called The Divorcee. I don't remember who is the leading actress, but she won the Academy Award for Best Actress that year. Don't remember when. But again, it was a huge success. During her life, she was actually maybe definitely richer, wealthier than Fitzgerald. At least just as famous, just as renowned. But dies again, not just poor, but her reputation dies along with her. She's kind of been forgotten by literature, by history, and it's a shame and it's unfair because this book has been, it was reissued in the 1980s. Not much success there, but it was actually just reissued last year. And I am so, so very glad I found it. I'm so very glad I've been reading it. It is just so much fun. Really, really recommend it to everyone, right? So and it's actually very fresh. I mean, you'd be surprised at reading it, just how up to date it feels. It's almost, I mean, doesn't feel like it was published in 1929, really. Feels like it's more from, you know, early turn of the century. And so it's basically the story of this woman, Patricia, who from the novel's first page is dealing with a divorce. Like, literally first chapter, it opens with my husband is leaving me, Peter, right? And you know, it's how she's dealing with it. She obviously does not want it. She is still very much in love, but the husband, maybe not so much. Peter and Patricia, they have this open marriage, which for the time was, I mean, if you think about it, this is the 1920s, right? Nearly 100 years ago, open marriage. I mean, it's very much of the time, but back then it was something just completely new. Radical, you just didn't do it, not like today. And as such, we have the husband, Peter, sleeping around with whomever, and Patricia knows about it, but she's kind of, right, agreed to this, and so she says, all right, it's fine, let's do this. So she also dances, she flirts around with a bunch of other men, but never goes right the whole way. Until finally, one night she does actually sleep with someone else, Peter's best friend, and she ends up confessing to Peter, right? She just feels really bad about it. She confesses to Peter, and guess what Peter does? You slut. I want a divorce. Just like that, right? So obviously we have this, the traditional double standard, right? It's an open marriage, yeah, but clearly asymmetric. He can do whatever he wants, she can't. So they separate, right? And this as well as after a pregnancy that he did not want, a child he didn't want. She keeps, the son dies at 2 months, and it's all very traumatic. So the book actually ends up exploring not just open relationships, divorce, but we also throw in there abortion, There's going to be themes of domestic violence, rape, all these just raw, brutal, difficult topics. But it's presented in a very, I don't want to say light, but it could be amusing, right, at times. She definitely treats it as, I mean, again, now she tells her husband that she's pregnant again, right, for the second time, and Peter just picks her up and throws her through a glass door, just like that, right? Breaks her arm. No, she scratches her arm, and she's just lying there thinking, Peter would never do that, but he did, right? And yet, she eventually goes to the doctor, goes to this abortion clinic, and she deals with all these things, right? She works. She's actually independent, financially, vocationally, but ultimately she's gonna find also this romantic and sexual independence, right? Even though the whole novel she's kind of like thinking, she's worried about missing. She misses Peter, kind of like at the forefront of her mind is always, how pretty do I look? Right? Am I wearing the latest trends? So there's a lot of shopping going on. There's a lot of references to designers, to the dresses she's wearing. She loves buying hats. She loves buying furs. She loves overspending. Right? There's a lot of girl math involved in here, and a lot of one night stands. A lot of drinking, Manhattans, martinis. Cosmos, scotch, all the time. She's wasted half of the novel and sleeping around the other half, right? But all at the same time, she's missing Peter and she's trying to do everything she can to kind of, maybe not actively win him back, but it's there, right? Like every time they talk, trying to arrange a divorce, it's always like, maybe this will be the night. If he kisses me tonight, everything's gonna be all right, and we're gonna go back to where we left off, and everything's gonna be right. So that's kind of what the novel is about. But again, in a very fresh and engaging style. So it's not just about marriage, and it's not just about divorce, right? It's also about the consequences and challenges of women's freedom that was new during the 1920s, right? They're still kind of dealing with this, and at different points in the novel, Patricia says that, at one point even, she says, women's freedom is the greatest gift to men, right? Because men kind of like take this step back and say, you want your freedom, you can have it. We're still gonna be doing whatever we want to, but we're no longer gonna be, you know, economically responsible for you, so you're off to, you know, fend for yourselves. And women, Patricia, you know, clearly says how women were struggling with this, right? Looking for jobs, trying to pay rent. And in New York City, right, all of this is very expensive. She moves in eventually with a friend of hers, Lucia. That's another important theme of the novel, right? Female friendship, how it's explored, how supportive they are of each other. Both are ex-wives, and they both kind of, you know, navigate through this new concept that society was dealing with, you know, being an ex-wife. And the friendship that arises from this, these two living as roommates, is also a great theme about the novel. One of my favorite parts also was seeing the interactions, the conversations between these two. Lucia is just so wise, so so easygoing, so laid back, and I have to admit, I kind of ended up having a thing for both of them. Patricia is actually really hot. She's witty, she's clever, she's beautiful. Professional, right? She works as a copywriter for a department store. And yeah, she's definitely attractive, very attractive. And she's gonna end up sleeping around, right, with a bunch of men. And so the novel ends up being very feminist, even though it's Ursula Parrott herself was not entirely convinced of the new feminism because precisely of the difficulties and challenges it posed to women at the turn of the century. The novel ends up being very feminist and very, very misandrist. And so that's why I think it's a very contemporary read. It should be read today more. It actually makes more sense to read today maybe than when it was issued the second time in the 1980s. I feel like today this is a book that everyone should be reading. And in fact, I'm going to, or my plan at least, is to be teaching this book alongside Gatsby next year with my 12th grade course. That's going to be the idea, right? To kind of compare these two books. We've got the, obviously, the Fitzgerald, very male, very, very, I mean, granted, the guy's an artist. The guy's one of my favorite authors, but it's still very limited. And here we have this other complementary side to it, right? Ursula Parrott, who brings this fresh voice, fresh insight, a different point of view to the same moment in time. The 1920s in New York City. So that's the plan for next year. I'm excited for that, having my students read these two takes, and well, we'll see how that goes. But for now, what we're gonna be doing here today is reading the last chapter. We're gonna finish the book at last. I haven't finished it. In fact, this book is so good. Just let me tell you, this book is so good, or I've enjoyed it so much that as soon as I finished the penultimate chapter, I started rereading it again, right away. I really liked it. I have a bunch of notes, it's so quotable. It's so modern too, right? Even though the story is very, you could say in certain ways, it's not like Fitzgerald, right? It's not artsy. It's not literary, usually. But it even has these moments of stream of consciousness. So it's, again, it's very modern, it's very innovative. To the point, and this is also, I was fascinated by this one chapter. There is this chapter where she even includes the musical notes, like the bars, right? You know, like musical sheet. She includes these notes in the chapter as sort of like section dividers within the chapter of Gershwin's Rhapsody in Blue. And it's almost as though we're reading this chapter and we're listening to a soundtrack. I mean, a book with a soundtrack, right? Included in it. It's just revolutionary. Like it's very, very new, right? No one at the time was doing something like this. So Ursula Parrott was onto, she knew her stuff, right? She knew what she was doing. Even though her character, Patricia, is at times clueless, at times, you know, ditzy, at times doesn't know where to go, doesn't know what to do, she is still very, very, very clever, very, very modern, very nice. But yeah, the man in the story. There are three men that she comes to meet. Very different from the rest. So the novel's not completely, you know, misandrist. It does say, look, they're not all the same, right? There's this guy in particular, Nat, who's so baby girl, right? The guy's just something else. It would have been nice to see something else happen between these two. But no, they're just friends and very supportive, very, I don't know. I mean, she's very insightful, Patricia. So let's read this last chapter. All right, we'll see how that goes. I'm excited. Finally, we're gonna be reading this. I'll be drinking here some homemade cold brew, finally. Oh man, that's good shit. And is that Is that good?
That's really good.
Yeah? That's pretty good. It's pretty good. And well, we'll see how it goes. So let's go to a break and we'll come back with the last chapter of Ursula Parrott's ex-wife on Litscapes. Wait, what? Are we still rolling? Is this a break?
We're still rolling.
Yeah? Everything? All right, cool.
Mm-hmm.
So? Let's do this, yeah? Let's get this party started. Finished? We've done the spoilers, right? Right, guys, of course, this is it. We're doing the last chapter of Ex-Wife by Ursula Parrott. Spoilers, please. If you're interested in the book, get a copy and read up to the penultimate chapter. Come back, join us for this final chapter. All right, so let's get to it. Oh, yeah. All right. Here we go. This is chapter 12. Now, the book runs just under 200 pages. It's actually a fairly short book. It's an easy read. Just under 200 pages here on my digital ebook. And this last chapter is going to be around 8 pages. All right. Chapter 12. Here we go. There remained no reason now for me to breakfast at 11 instead of 8 o'clock. I gave up my noon to 7 o'clock job and found one from 9 to 5 at a better salary. Before beginning at the new place, I went to Bermuda for a fortnight. Bermuda because a letter from Bill came along while I was trying to think of somewhere that I wanted to go. The letter read, "My dear Patricia, over brandy flips in the morning and champagne cup at night, I wish you were here. The climate and the scenery and the absence of automobiles make me able to believe that the last 20 years haven't happened, except when I look at the women's clothes. Can you take a vacation? If you turn up, I'll take you to the damn fool racetrack that reminds me of county fairs in Maryland when I was young. All your generation should go to the tropics for 10 years anyway and watch roses blooming under palm trees. You'd all come back languid enough to be ladylike. I don't suppose you'll leave your silly job, but if you would, I'd take you driving in a carriage and you could pretend you were one of your own aunts, exhibiting gentle alarm at my recklessness if I went around the corner at a gallop." No, we don't. No, Patricia, do not go with Bill, like I said. If anything, you want to go with either Nat or Ken. Not Bill. Come on. But let's see how this goes. "I thought it might be pleasant to contemplate Bill's contented old age for a couple of weeks, so I cabled him and sailed." Damn it, Patricia. What did I just tell you? Don't go. But all right. "But I stayed at a hotel about a mile from Bill's. Less contemplation of contented old age through all my walking hours should grow monotonous. In the mornings I swam before breakfast and dressed and had breakfast and sat about languidly on the hotel terrace, looking at the palm trees and thinking about nothing until Bill's white sturdy figure rose over the brow of the hill. Well, let's do a bit of a pub crawling before luncheon. Cheer you up. You look as if you needed a bit of cheering up. God knows why, you're young." Something like that was his invariable greeting. Then he walked down to the landing and took a launch for Hamilton, while Bill told me I wore white or blue or yellow or whatever I was wearing well. In the Bermudiana bar, Bill sat with a brandy flip in front of him, his wide red kind face beaming, explaining that all I needed was a husband, and considering, in his strong loud voice, those of his contemporaries who might qualify. "We're all too damn old for you, Pat, though. Wish I knew some younger man. Wish I'd had sons." Don't give him any, Pat.
How do you?
And he sighed briefly for the sons whose non-existence was the only apparent regret of his life. Then he trotted me about Hamilton, every day, muttering, "Women like trinkets, always cheers a woman up to buy her trinkets." At intervals he vanished, briefly, into some little shop to reappear with coral necklaces or earrings or brooches that were not suitable for wear with anything I owned, but that I wore with everything. In the afternoons, he played golf with men of his age. Right, of course, expected. I went alone and sat on unbelievably pink sands and watched incredibly blue and white waves come curling into shore and read The World of William Clissold. Through long afternoons, while the shadows of the palm trees lengthened across the sands and the small breeze fragrant of sea and palms and roses blew gaily along the shore, I read and reread that section of the second volume where Mr. Wells considers the relationship of men and women. Very meta. That's actually what this book is ultimately about, right? Just like, I mean, just like War and Peace, right? Tolstoy. It's not about War and Peace, right? It's about that relationship between men and women and that endless struggle for each to try to understand the other. That's what this book is ultimately about. And here she is, our girl, reading about that on the sand. Kind of wish I were on the sand, on the beach myself, but anyhow, here I am with you guys. Not so bad. I found therein solace for my resentment against the stupid jest I had long called secretly this damn freedom for women. There it is again, right? This damn freedom for women. There were sentences by Mr. Wells. "We live sexually in a world of mixed and broken codes and irregular and extravagant experiments and defiances. Our ways of living are more provisional now than our governments. One finds a companion mate as a dream in the hearts of a few people where here and there, as an experiment, an almost hopeless experiment, like a match lit in a high wind or a swimmer borne away by a stream." I read that and looked at the shadows of the palm trees on the sand and thought, "Noel, Noel." Shit, I lost my place for trying to drink coffee and read at the same time. Silly me. And thought, "Noel, Noel, a dream made real, an experiment achieved, and a dream lost, an experiment ended forever. But it did not end in shabbiness and recriminations, so there remains something. Something, perhaps very much, a fire to warm my hands at all the days of my life." Ouch. "And I was able to even to make a jest to myself about Noel and me. It was not a very gay jest. It was, well, we both were destined to see palm trees, but not in the same country. I went back from these solitary afternoons to dine and drink champagne cup with Bill and to listen to Bill's stories of the early 1900s, feeling as serene as I used to feel on coming home from afternoons of sailing in a breeze that was strong and exciting when I was a very young girl. And if sometimes I waked at night and listened to the warm, steady wind sweeping through the palm trees outside and ached rather horribly for Noel, whom I would not ever see again, still, I knew that ache would pass and was quite sure, this time, that remembrance of lovely things we had shared would long outlast the ache that they were ended. I went back to New York, feeling that I had been away a long time. Lucia met me at the dock." Ah, oh, finally, Lucia's back. Because Lucia, remember, she had moved out. Right? She had moved out. Off to marry again, and God, I missed her. I missed Lucia. "Lucia met me at the dock. It was a great comfort to see her. I said, Thank heaven, darling, you aren't likely to dash off to Asia or South America or elsewhere permanently ever. I look forward to spending weekends with you in Westchester when we're both daughtering. Thanks, she said. You are looking all beautifully rested. But tell me, are you convalescing? I think so. I got my baggage through the customs and we started uptown in Lucia's car. I hauled a bottle of Creme Yvette out of my blouse and for Lucia and said, I've been wearing corsets all day for your sake, to keep this from falling through. I hope you are appreciative. Oh, darling, my favorite liquor, she said. But I don't know whether I can drink it. I'm going to have a baby. I think I'm very pleased and Sam is, of course, radiant. I'm dieting like mad, though, so that I shan't permanently ruin what figure I have. They give you a funny diet. That's grand about the baby if you want it, I said. Lucia's conversation was noticeably circuitous. Her usual method of approaching some news that might be distressing in effect. She looked out of the car window. It always seems to rain in New York when people come back from cruises, I've noticed, she said. Peter and Judith have a daughter, I hear. My God. Fucking Peter. You know, this douchebag who did not want kids. Now with this pick-me girl, Judith, he has a daughter? Fuck him. I was not glad or sorry or specially interested. I said, everyone seems to be doing something about the next generation, except me. You are young yet, Patricia. Listen, Nathaniel's staying with us. Nat, there he is, finally. Oh, man. His father finally died and left Nat all his money with a note saying that he appreciated the years Nat gave up to looking after him. Nat is taking it very hard. The note seems to have made him feel that he never was nice to his father, was impatient with him and so on. All that sort of thing is so dreadfully futile. But Nat isn't something of a state. I know, I said. Nathaniel is such a dear. Yeah, he is such a dear. Ah, poor guy. Lucia looked at me for an instant, speculatively. No, darling, I said. All I want is peace. I feel as old as time, no matter how perennial I look. I know, said Lucia. A comfortable fact about all of us, though, is that we have got through so much so fast, there can't be much left. I doubt if this will be a long-lived generation. We shall reach sedateness via emotional exhaustion by 40 and die of senility at 48. I was afraid that the news about Nathaniel would disturb you. Or was it the news about Pete that you were afraid of? I asked. Nothing is ever going to disturb me much again. That's grand, said Lucia. She looked very preoccupied. Then, Pat, would you think me a horribly greedy woman if I got the chauffeur to open this bottle somehow and stop for glasses somewhere and we drank some of the Creme Yvette now? I do adore it. And I'm so afraid the doctor will forbid it. If I had a little before I asked him, it couldn't hurt me much. We drank Creme Yvette all the way to Lucia's house and were unable to eat dinner, but the Creme Yvette had tasted so good that we did not care. Here's cheers to that. Nathaniel seemed very glad to see me. He was looking unhappy. He's lost his occupation in life, Lucia said later. He has been devoted to his father for the 8 or 9 years since he was 20 and feels lost with no responsibility now. I'm going to suggest that he adopt an orphan. Poor darling. Nevertheless, Sam and Lucia and Nat and I had a pleasant enough weekend, and then I went to work. January went by slushily and drearily. So did February. I worked very hard and missed Noel very badly and hunted through the Times for his stories as they appeared. They were not signed, and I was never quite sure whether they were his or someone else's. They were written from some very faraway place. One rainy March day, I found Nathaniel waiting for me in my hallway when I came home from work. He was looking more cheerful than I had seen him all winter. When I brought him upstairs, he began flinging bright colored booklets from an envelope he carried all across the couch. They were travel booklets. His voice was jubilant. "Pat, the doctor says I should leave the business in the hands of the office manager. He knows more about it than I do anyway, and go on a trip. Do you know, I haven't been anywhere for so many years, I didn't realize that I could go now." I took off my hat and laid it on a table and smoothed my hair. I should miss Nat too, but it was nice that he should go places he had wanted to for so long. "Where are you going, Nat?" He began picking up booklets and waving them at me. "I don't know. Bermuda, Cuba, Florida, New Orleans." "You blessed idiot," I said. "Why not around the world?" He looked at me as if I had produced two full-sized rabbits from the small hat on the table. "My God," he said, "I could go around the world." "Wait a moment, darling, and I'll mix you a drink to help you get used to the idea," I said. "You must promise to send me postcards of mosques and things." I was tired and had a cold and wished I could summon more enthusiasm about it because Nat was such a pleasant person. "Don't mix the drink yet," he said. "I want to tell you something. I want you to come along with me." I stared at him. He began to talk very fast. Oh my God. "I want you to marry me. I mean, oh, I know you've never thought of that. I mentioned it just once when I was tight, I think. Perhaps I am not passionately in love with you, but if you don't mind that, we might have fun. You are very gay to go places with. It would be lovely to have you along on a trip around the world, and I should be very lonely by myself. I am fond of you, you know." Oh my God, things are heating up. Nat and Pat. I mean, I guess it has a nice ring to it, but, let's see what she says. I still stared at him. I said, "I am fond of you, too. I suppose I like you better than any man I know nowadays." Not very convincing, Pat. Come on, you can do better. His voice was more confident than it had been. "Better come along then, Pat, and that'll be that." I remembered having heard someone say that his father made decisions fast. "Nat, dear, just a minute." I felt very tired. I wanted to say to God or Noel or someone who would understand, "I have traveled such a long way, all the way through youth, I think, and I am so tired. You must not blame me too much for taking what shelter offers now." I smiled at Nathaniel and I said, "I'll be able to talk in an instant, darling. Is that all right?" "Of course, Pat, child," he said. "I didn't mean to startle you." I looked at my hat lying on the table beside an unread copy of the Times. I looked at the dark outside the windows. Rain was splashing hard against the panes. I wished that I were not too tired to think. And the wave of remembrance of Noel swept over me. Vividly, as if I had seen him an hour before, I could remember his smile and the exact shade of his hair and the way his mouth felt when he bent down to kiss me. Noel, who had lifted me for a while to the level of his strength. Remembrances enfolded me warmly, ebbed, and were gone. I stood alone in a room with Nathaniel. I said, "Nat, how about my gaudy past? I am supposed to have had one, you know." He shrugged his shoulders. "Would have had one myself if I had been you, no doubt. That doesn't bother me. I'd as soon not know the details, though." I said, "All right, I'll marry you, Nat, dear. Thank you for asking me." We both laughed, he kissed me, and we went to dinner. Lucia was very pleased. As I am. Yeah, me too, definitely. We were married one April afternoon at the municipal building where, long ago, someone with the same name as I had married Peter. A phrase in the ceremony seemed vaguely familiar. Do you promise to cleave to him only, forsaking all others, as long as you both shall live? Well, this time, it might be true. Because Nathaniel's father had died so recently, we had no other celebration. We were sailing that midnight, going around the world. We have a chapter break here. Let's see. Well, I'm pleased, definitely, for both of them. Like I said, Nat is, he is a sweetheart. He is, right, definitely so baby girl. I feel like Pat, after everything she's gone through with Peter and everyone else, I feel like she deserves someone that's gonna make her happy. And I do feel like Nat could make her happy. But there is a but, right? And I don't want to get to the but just yet because I know Ursula Parrott's life. And I know this is very autobiographical. But let's not ruin it for us just yet. All our friends came to the boat to wish us bon voyage. I said appropriate things in answer to their felicitations until my throat hurt from talking and talking. Bill was ill and could not come to the boat, but he sent us a case of champagne by his own bootlegger, a very large Italian who appeared suddenly, made a flowery speech wishing us long life, and gave us a detailed account of his difficulties in getting the champagne aboard. It was excellent champagne. We began to drink it immediately. When it was almost all gone, people began saying goodbye. Lucia drew me aside and said, "Do you like your ermine wrap? I helped Nathaniel choose it for you." I said, "It's a beautiful one." "Why did he want to get me an ermine wrap?" "Ever since he read The Green Hat, Nat thinks ermine wraps are robes of romance. Pat, he's a grand person." She hesitated then. "It's none of my affair, Pat, but are you thinking that Asia is a large place or a small one? Because remember that Noel is in Asia." We regarded each other. I said, "It is a large place, Lucia. Still, one never knows." Lucia said, "That'll be all right, I suppose." She ran her finger down the ermine cloak. "It might be labeled success in the American edition, Patricia." We smiled at each other. She went away. Everyone else was gone except Nathaniel. He said, "Patricia, I'm going upstairs to send a wire or radio or whatever one sends at the last minute to Bill to thank him for the wine. Then I'll come back to take you on deck so that we can watch New York go by." The steward was clearing away the champagne bottles and glasses from our living room. I went into our bedroom. Champagne bottles and glasses were all over the place. I put on fresh lipstick and powder and perfume. I felt warm with champagne and interested in going around the world. There was a long mirror on the door of the bedroom. I walked toward it and stood still. In the mirror, a small, slim young woman stood. She had black, straight, shining hair, gray eyes, and a curved red mouth. Around her eyes, there were faint shadows. There would be lines in 10 years, but not for 10 years. She wore a rose-colored net dress. One side of its ruffled skirt swung out like a half-opened fan. She wore an ermine wrap, negligently, over her shoulders. They were creamy shoulders that many men had kissed, and that now only one man would kiss, probably. She did not look happy or unhappy. She looked a little tired and a little amused. I wondered what she was like underneath her attitude, but I knew now that neither I nor anyone else would ever be sure as to that. She and I bowed to each other gravely, and I went to join Nathaniel. Nathaniel and I stood silent. The ship moved smoothly down the river, and we watched New York move past. Nathaniel put a friendly hand on my shoulder. Slipping past, the lights of city skyscrapers, and with them all my life. Peter, Patrick, Kenneth, Lucia, Noel, voices and sounds of people and things I used to know. Nathaniel spoke. You won't be lonely, Patricia? No, my dear. He flung his arms out toward that fantastic skyline. We shall come back, Patricia, and build a skyscraper or two. Then we'll go on again. I want to see all the cities of the world. Cape Town and Budapest and Moscow, Canton and Calcutta and Yokohama. I love the sounds of their names. His voice grew graver. I mean to be very good to you, Patricia. It was easy to slip an arm through his. It would be very easy to be very good to Nathaniel, always. What are you thinking, Patricia? That I mean to make you a perfect wife, Nathaniel. He smiled down at me, happily. I did mean it. Yet I shall hope, through all my youth, through all my life, that in some far city I shall find my love again. New York lights blurred behind us. That was a shining city.
Oh, man. Oh, damn. That was it.
And that's the book. And that's the book. Yeah. Ouch. Yeah, so first off, that last line, let me just read it again. That last line. New York lights blurred behind us. That was a shining city.
You know, I wanted to mention at some point that I actually started reading this book
on my first visit to New York. It was coincidental. I had not been really planning it. It was just I was on the bus from DC to New York City, and I'm like, okay, I need a new book. Let's try Ex-Wife. And it could not have gone better. This book just captures New York so gloriously, splendidly. I read it and I feel like I'm in New York all over again, walking at night through Central Park.
Do you visualize it more vivid than The Great Gatsby?
Like, yeah. Great Gatsby transmits me to the 20s. This one gets me to New York City. The 20s, a couple months ago, whenever, but I'm there. I'm in the city again. Yeah, definitely. And I, you know, it feels like I would like to read Ulysses in Dublin, or, you know, I don't know, Cien Años de Soledad in Macondo, or something like that, right? That's what it's like. Like, it really captures the essence of a place. The city itself is almost a breathing, tortured and torturing character. But anyhow, the ending. I was not expecting it. I was not expecting it in the least, because I remember that Nat and Ken and even Bill were kind of like, just, you know, they were there one moment. She enjoyed their company, their friendship and everything, and then they were gone and she kept sleeping around until she finally met Noel, who eventually left with his wife. And the fact that Nat's back, I liked it, but here's the thing though. The butt, right, that you mentioned. Ursula Parrott, after her first divorce, you know, dealing with it, writes this novel, Ex-Wife, right? But it turns out she's gonna be divorced 3 times later on, right? 4-time divorcee. That was just kind of like her life, right? From one to the next, on and on. Who knows what could happen with Nat, but at least for now, the idea that she could be, if not happy, then certainly not sad, right? I could see her singing along to Lana Del Rey, "Don't ask if I'm happy, you know that I'm not, but at best I can say I'm not sad." That's her. That's gonna be her in the end of this novel. I like the ending. It's poignant. I like Pat and Nat, but she's never gonna be happy again. But at least she'll be content,
right? At the very least, I think she's gonna have a pleasant time, because that's Nat. And I actually want to go back to in the book to when they meet. It's a really, really good scene. It's one of my favorite moments in the novel. Again, those of you reading along with us will remember that Nat and Pat meet in a story. And let me go back here in my... I don't remember which chapter. But it's like chapter, I want to say like 7, 8? Let's check right now real quick, right? So this scene, man, this scene had me just cracking up, right? Laughing my ass off. I remember I was in the airport lounge waiting a very delayed flight. I think I had left already DC and I was in San Antonio flying back to Mexico City. And I'm reading this scene and I'm just laughing out loud. Honestly, like everyone was looking at me like, the fuck's wrong with this guy? I don't know, I just found it very, very funny. Wait a minute. I highlighted it as the part where Pat says there were three men, right, who were like, who came to be constants in my life. Here we go. Yeah, she says, actually, three men came to be fixtures among the transients, right? Just these three men who are constantly there for her, but again, in a positive way. So not all men are villains, everyone, just so you know. So they meet, right? They meet at a party and they go, neither of them are having a pleasant time at the party. And they go out on a cab, right? A drive around town. And because he tells her, let's get out of here. Let's drive around town for a while. And this is the scene, right? This is when they meet. And that's why I think that Nat and Pat could be good together. If not for real, you know, that sincere happiness that we're all striving for, authentic, but at least for just feeling good about where you're at and who you're with. I think they could find that with each other. Anyhow, so it says, by around the city, he had meant literally that. West Street by the docks to the Battery, and up the far east side, where bits of the river showed at the street ends. I thought he himself was about the most wholesome looking person I had seen in months. He had a brown hair that would have curled untidily if it were not so close-clipped, wide-set gray eyes, a curious sensitive mouth, a good chin, a beautiful, vaguely striped suit, and a necktie I did not like. It looked a little consciously vagabondish. To offset that, he had enormous, well-shaped, muscular hands. He was fun. He talked about the shapes and colors and flavors of things. I knew in half an hour that he had a passion for beauty beyond anyone I had ever met. An impersonal sort of passion for line and form and tone. He talked about the curved hulls of ships, I remember, with a warmth I had heard in other men's voices when, over wine, they remembered some woman whom they had loved very much. God, I love that line. Just that description of Nathaniel is so, like again, it captures totally his personality, you know, his passion. I had decided that this Nathaniel person was altogether engaging, when suddenly he took off his hat, bent down, kissed the corner of my mouth, let me go instantly, and without drawing breath, announced, "You kiss very badly. I shan't kiss you again." I laughed and laughed and laughed. And that was me also, right? At this airport lounge, laughing and laughing and laughing. But not just at him, right? Also at her, like her, you know, her capacity to just pick up on this dude's lame attempt at a pickup line. But his reaction is also very wholesome. He grew embarrassed. He blushed beautifully. I kept on laughing. When I could breathe, I said, "Do you always make that speech?" "Tell you sometime," he said. "There's a marvelous show of modern French painters at the Duddinson Gallery. Could you leave your office a bit early tomorrow and see it?" "Love to," I said. Months later, he told me about the speech in the cab. The day before he met me, his roommate at college had been jeering him about his lack of line with women, and had recommended kissing them within the first hour of meeting, telling them they kissed atrociously, and watching them prove how wrong that statement was. Nat said he had felt the speech might also serve to indicate that he was enormously sophisticated, and then he could go on taking women to art galleries and Russian restaurants without bothering further about personalities. Oh man, again, that scene just cracked me up. Nat seemed just very, very wholesome. And the way they both react, right? Like she's just laughing at him, you know, calling him out on his, on this lame attempt. And he blushes, he's embarrassed, but in this very sincere and he just keeps it going, right? And well, they end up married. And I remember I was reading this part at the airport, and I was thinking, I should try that line, just see how it goes. I don't know if it would fly, right, this day and age, but think about that. You're on this first date, this very pretty woman, right? And just out of the blue, you kiss her without being, you know, too invasive, right? But you kiss her and then you back off and you're like, "Wow, you kissed really bad. I will never kiss you again." And then try to see if she tries to prove you wrong. I don't know. I just found it hilarious. I kind of felt like trying it myself, and that's Nat. That is Nathaniel, right? So I at least for one, I'm happy for them. I'm happy for Patricia. I know she will miss, and I will miss Noel, but at least she's done with Peter. Total asshole. I mean, yeah, I'm so glad that's over with, right? So there it is, guys. That's the book. That is the book, Ex-Wife by Ursula Parrott. Again, published in 1929, reissued last year by McNally Editions. It's a 5 out of 5, totally. I mean, really, this book has become one of my recent favorites. I am so glad to have read the ending with you. I am so glad to have shared this with you. Really, thank you all for joining us on this first attempt, this first episode at Litscapes. And we'll see how it goes, right? Hopefully, from here, sky's the limit. Everyone, once again, thank you all for being here. Thank you all for your time. It's been a real pleasure. It's been a real honor. So that's gonna do it for today's episode of Litscapes. All right, everyone, get the fuck out of here.